So I want to tell you about the stable marriage problem. And what I really like about it is it's completely unlike the kind of mathematics that most people have seen in high school or in college even. There's no numbers involved. We're not computing anything. No calculations, no integrals.
No numbers.
Oh, no numbers even.
I'm going then.
let me pose the problem. So I'm going to play the role of a yenta. So let's say I live in a remote village, and there are a bunch of young men and a bunch of young women, and it's in the village's interest that everybody gets married, everybody pairs off. We're only talking about heterosexual marriages today. That's actually really important to the mathematics, but let's leave that aside for now. And I get to arrange the marriages. I get to choose. I know all the young men and young women very well. I know what their preferences are, but it's really ultimately up to me. And my ultimate goal, my principal goal in arranging these marriages is stability. So I don't mean stability over time. People might grow apart, their preferences might change. But I mean instead the following scenario. Say I've arranged a marriage between this couple here, so this young man and this young woman. And then I've arranged another marriage here for another couple, another man, another woman. But suppose this woman prefers this man to the husband that I've assigned her, and this man simultaneously prefers this woman to his wife that I've assigned.
That's not good.
That means that these two are gonna say, to hell with this arrangement, and run off together. So that's what we want to avoid. So I'll say this situation is not stable. And then the question today is it possible, is it always possible to arrange stable marriages? So I want this instability that I've just described to never occur. So it's quite possible that this woman really dislikes the husband that I've assigned her. And so she in particular would prefer this guy, but he's maybe very happy with his wife. He prefers her to her. So she wants to trade, but he doesn't want to trade. So this is a stable configuration, even though not everybody's thrilled with the arrangement. Instability is if and only if two people simultaneously prefer each other to their assigned spouses. Any other situation is stable. That's the one we're trying to avoid.
How big a group are we talking here?
I'm going to have no bounds on size whatsoever. So there could be, you know, the 6 billion people that are on the planet, if we want, or, you know, 10 men, 10 women in a remote village, and people can have any preferences whatsoever. I can't control what people feel in their own hearts. So it's a big question, and it's not at all obvious that the answer is yes. And furthermore, even if the answer is yes, there's a computational question. Is it maybe there is some stable marriage configuration out there in the universe, but I need to be able to find it too. I need a way to actually make the arrangements so that I can tell everybody who they're going to be spending the rest of their lives with. So the answer is yes, and the proof is constructive. There's an algorithm due to David Gale and Lloyd Shapley in a 1962 paper on college admissions and the stability of marriage that proves that this can always be done. And so I'd like to describe that algorithm to you now. This is an algorithm that you can program a computer to run, but I like to describe it as via a metaphor where the men and women are playing certain roles. So before we begin, each man and each woman rank the members of the opposite sex. So in other words, everybody submits a preference list, you know, one through the end of how many, or who they'd like to be married to. So then on the first day of the algorithm, we'll have each woman proposes to her number one choice. So some of the men will receive multiple proposals, others will receive none whatsoever. So the ones with multiple proposals then make some rejections. So each man rejects all but his top suitor. So at the end of this step, we have what we'll call tentative engagements. So some of women make proposals that aren't rejected yet, and those couples are tentatively engaged, but we'll see that the algorithm isn't quite finished just yet. So on day two, each rejected woman, so each woman whose proposal was rejected the day before, proposes to her next best choice, regardless of whether he's free or not. So some men will receive new proposals, others won't receive any. And the men now have a chance to trade up. So maybe you had a tentative engagement from the day before, but you have a better suitor now, so you can break the previous engagement and make a new match. So again, each man rejects all but his top suitor. So this is why we said the engagements are tentative. If at any time a woman that he likes even better proposes to him, he's free to reject and break the previous engagement and become tentatively engaged to somebody he prefers.
So he can keep waiting for a better offer.
He can keep waiting for a better offer. Then on day...
This is terrible for the women.
Three, four, well, you think that now, but wait till the end. So this is day three, four, five, and so on. We just repeat this process. So any woman who is rejected the day before proposes to her next choice. And the men, again, have an opportunity to trade up. If they receive better proposals, they'll break the previous engagements and keep going. And then the claim is that this stops at some point. And furthermore, once this algorithm stops and the final engagements are stable in the sense we discussed previously. Let's see an example of how this whole process works. So what I've done here is I've created four hypothetical women, Charlotte, Elizabeth, Jane, and Lydia, and four hypothetical men with kind of funny names, Bingley, Collins, Darcy, and Wickham. And then for each person, I've listed preferences. So Charlotte prefers Bingley to Darcy to Collins to Wickham, similarly for Elizabeth, Jane, and Lydia. And the men have preferences also. Bingley prefers Jane to Elizabeth to Lydia to Charlotte, and so on and so forth. So let's run the algorithm and see who ends up married to whom. So remember, on the first day, each woman proposes to her best choice. So Charlotte proposes to Bingley, Elizabeth to Wickham, Jane to Bingley, and Lydia to Bingley. So see, Bingley receives three proposals right off the bat from Charlotte, from Jane, and from Lydia. And Wickham receives one proposal from Elizabeth. Okay, Bingley right now has a choice. He prefers Jane to Lydia and Charlotte. So he'll reject these two. That is, Lydia and Charlotte are both rejected. And at the end of the first day, we have two tentative engagements, Elizabeth to Wickham and Jane to Bingley. On the second day, Charlotte and Lydia, which were rejected the day before, make their proposals. So Charlotte proposes to Darcy. Darcy is proposed to by Charlotte. And Lydia proposes to Wickham. Wickham receives a proposal from Lydia. Now, Wickham was tentatively engaged to Elizabeth, but he likes Lydia better. So he's now gonna reject Elizabeth, and she's back on the market. All right, so at the end of the second day, we have three tentative engagements, Charlotte to Darcy, Jane to Bingley, Lydia to Wickham, and Elizabeth is unengaged. So on the third day, she proposes, this time to Darcy. Darcy receives a proposal from Elizabeth, who he prefers to Charlotte, so she's rejected. And we have three tentative engagements again, Elizabeth to Darcy, Jane to Bingley, Lydia to Wickham. Now on the third day, Charlotte proposes to her next choice, which is Collins. You can see that Collins doesn't actually think very highly of Charlotte. He prefers Jane, Elizabeth, and Lydia, but he hasn't received any other proposals. He has no better option, so he says yes. And now the algorithm terminates because everybody is engaged.
That's fun, isn't it?
Yeah. All right, so now's the time for the mathematics. I'm going to describe a number of theorems. Now, he is only going to reject her proposal if there's some other woman, I'll write W prime for some other woman,